Ladies and gentlemen, come gather around. Today, we're going to try to get the AC going on this PT Cruiser. Although having worked on it now for quite a while, I think it's more of a PTSD cruiser. Let's go! So before you jump into any kind of repair on a vehicle, you want to really know what is wrong with it and what's going on. When I did the timing belt on this, check the video link up here, because oh my gosh, when I did the timing belt of this, one of the things you have to do is split the AC system to get the timing belt out. Thank you, Chrysler. So when I did, you're supposed to have a refrigerant recovery system that collects all of the stuff so it doesn't float off into Never Never Land and put a hole in our ozone layer. Well, this system was largely empty, so there wasn't anything in it. Once I got the timing belt all back together, I need to recharge the AC. It was not charged to begin with, wasn't operational, so I want to find out why. So, we're going to try a couple things first. One of the first things I'm going to do is check and see if there's any leaks. For that, I need to use a bathroom. I need to use a bathroom. I'll be right back. All right, back for the bathroom. Speaking of evacuation, one of the things you're going to need in air conditioning is to evacuate that system too. And you're going to need a vacuum pump. And I tried cobbling together a vacuum pump that I got from somewhere, figured I'd make it work for AC. This was like $100 US, and don't leave home without it. This is like so worth it. So I picked this up so that I could hook it up to the AC system and evacuate all of the refrigerant in there. Now, that thing's heavy. You don't want to have any moisture in the AC system, okay? Any moisture, it's going to get cold, it's going to freeze, you're going to have some issues. So you got to make sure there's no moisture. Vacuum, pressure, you can change boiling points of things. Propane in your barbecue tank boils at minus 40, which is why when you open the valve, it comes out as a gas, because it's instantly boiling inside the propane tank. Water boils, sorry, that's Celsius. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius, and if we put it into a vacuum, we can lower that boiling point a whole lot lower and boil it at like room temperature. I have a gauge that measures vacuum. I usually hook it up to a motor for it to help with tuning or diagnostics, and you can figure out how much you suck. Ooh, new record. Not a number you necessarily want to brag about. This vacuum pump can drop 30 inches of vacuum, which is about almost twice a running engine's amount of vacuum, which should boil the moisture out of the system fairly well. We usually hook up the thing for about 30, 45 minutes, and then just seal it up and see if it holds it. So we're gonna see if it holds the vacuum. I've got some gauges here that I picked up off of Amazon. I've never used these ones before, but all I'm doing right now is making this little pump pull a vacuum on here because I want to see if there's a leak. So I held a vacuum overnight. The next thing I want to do is figure out, is the compressor going to work? Because maybe this thing wasn't operational because there's something wrong with there. So I'm going to find a low pressure switch, which is on the dryer, an accumulator or a receiver, the whole whatever. And I'm going to jump that, bypass that. The low pressure switch is a switch that if the pressure is too low, it doesn't let the compressor turn on. So I just want to make sure that the compressor actually can turn on when I put pressure into it. So this is how you do that. So down here in the bowels of this turd, this crazy looking guy right here is the low pressure switch. What I did is I got in there and popped that off, and I just took this little piece of electrical wire. It's just like one of these, and I put it across the two with the key on and the engine running. This would jump, it would make the connection for you. So I'm not depending on actual pressure. This is like, yeah, for sure I want you to go on. So I jumped that, and the clutch did not engage at all. So it turns out the compressor does not turn on, and it could just be the clutch. Rock Auto doesn't sell a clutch for this for me. I could probably hunt for one, but a new compressor from Rock Auto is like $300 Canadian. I got a junkyard not far from here. I'm gonna go check that out. Turns out a PT Cruiser has a different compressor depending on whether you are a standard transmission or a manual transmission. This thing is a stick. Wish me luck in finding a compressor. Luckily, there's a pick and pull nearby, so I got another compressor for $40. So it turns out the neon compressors are the same as the manual transmission compressors, and insider tip, you can get the neon compressor out easily. Not so much on this. And because I'm an idiot and put my 61 Chevy on the hoist, which currently does not run or drive, we get to do this old school on the ground. And I am so looking forward to that. It's going to be an awesome time. Carrying on.
So, using my Princess Auto floor jack, and these black jack stands are from Kmart. I don't know if anybody even has a Kmart anymore, but I got those when I was about 13. I still have them, I still use them, and I'm not completely scared about them. But check out the video up on the top right to take you through the safety of using jack stands, the poor man's lift. And here we are, getting ready to have a whole bunch of not fun.
I forgot to show how to disconnect that, but it's like one bolt. You got this.
So the first thing I did here is disconnect the high and low pressure lines off of the compressor. And I think working on a PT Cruiser, extensions, universals, and air tools are probably going to be your best friends. And probably Band-Aids. Here, I'm trying to undo the top two bolts on the compressor. They use a 13 millimeter wrench. You can barely see where they are. You can barely fit your hand in there. I tried a whole bunch of different ways and then discovered once they're loose, you cannot physically remove the bolt from the compressor. They're about 5 inches long and totally get in the way. So I argued with this for quite a while. And then I think I just gave up and started working on the bottom. So we're going to jump to that. So underneath, there are two more bolts that are longer than can possibly be removed from the vehicle, and I eventually had to get a little medieval with this. I couldn't get them far enough out. There, you can see a little bit of skanky little white corrosion in these little slots where the threads go through, and they corroded the steel bolt to the aluminum compressor in such a way that you can't actually physically remove them. So we're going to have to get a little medieval. Lucky, lucky me.
Okay, the word of the day is exasperated. There's a plastic little thing you can take off of here. The grill will pop up. It'll probably snap out of these or snap off. And then there's quarter turn fasteners that clip into here to lock the top of the rad on. And then you can take this off. There'll be a crazy little nut here. I don't know what that is, but it's clearly broken. And then you can pull this far enough away to almost get everything out through here. I also found the fasteners corroded really well against the compressor. Another reason why you should be using Neverseize when you're putting this stuff together, because somebody's going to have to take this apart, and that somebody might be you. So, I don't like that. Still have to get the bottom bolts out of here, or the compressor, and it's totally not loving me today. But that's okay, because I am not loving it either. I don't know if I can get those out.
So I argued with it for a while, now I'm getting medieval, and I just cut off the protruding head and threads of the fastener. What's left is still stuck in the compressor. I don't care. And you're also probably saying you shouldn't be wearing gloves when using power tools, and I appreciate that, but I don't care. And here we are. Apparently the factory service manual is just remove the compressor. Be nice if they were a little more useful than that. Not fun. Now, the connectors. Anytime I get something from the junkyard, I get all the connectors, electrical connectors. I take all the fasteners just in case I need some. So while, yes, I cut the bolts, when I took the neon compressor, I took the bolts because you never really know. And I did have to replace the high-pressure switch electrical connection on the harness of the PT Cruiser because this one... something was buggered. So here I am removing the high pressure one. This one, if the pressure is too high, it will stop the compressor from turning on. It turns the compressor off is what it does. Seems to work. But I ended up reusing that plug because the one on the PT itself was kind of buggered. To put it all back together, you got to pry the motor back enough to get the compressor in between that, and then you got to rotate it magically over in a space that's not quite big enough to fit your hands. I used a crowbar. Here's the bolts. Wire wheels are nice and clean. Never seize so that if I'm in here again, and with my luck I will be, I can get them apart again. I am a huge fan of putting never seize on any fasteners that I use so that I can get them apart again in how many of a year's time it's going to be. So you can't really slip in the bolts and do them up one at a time. You kind of have to figure out how to shove them all into the compressor and then shove the compressor into place, knowing that some of the bolts will hit the radiator support and not be able to get into the right location. Yay, PT Cruisers. I think if I were to ever have this motor out, there's some areas where I will just bludgeon them with a hammer to make sure there's more clearance. Or even better yet, cut the floor out and put a V8 in the front and convert it to rear-wheel drive. Tilt nose front end, that would be so much better. I have plans for that. I've talked to my kid that when he moves on to the next vehicle, I get the PT Cruiser and I'll make something delicious out of it. Not necessarily street legal. Shh. So, doing up the bolts on the compressor. Top and or bottom. And then I think I argued with the electrical connection for a bit and ended up cutting it off and soldering the one on that I nicked with the neon compressor. Seems to be all interchangeable. Not shown in the video is when I hooked up the hoses and then broke a bolt off and had to pull the compressor out again. Drill out the broken bolt, rethread the hole, and put it all back in a second time. Because why do it once when you can do it like twice or three times? Just for giggles. Airlines going in. Switch is hooked up. And then I'm putting in a little bit of PAG 46 oil to make sure I've got some oil in the compressor. And then we're pulling a vacuum and see how much it sucks. I can tell you how much it sucks. Oh boy, can I ever. So while it's sucking, pulling a vacuum to see that there's no leaks and to get rid of any potential moisture in there, we are doing up the whole rest of the vehicle. Lucky, lucky me. Hey, look, never seize. Yeah, it's like I've done this before. Oh my gosh. I did see on a YouTube video somewhere where somebody had pulled the whole front off to help with the timing belt, probably to make it easier to get at the power steering pump bolts. And I don't know. It actually came apart fairly nice. That's good thinking. Not my favorite vehicle to work on. I imagine that crazy switch in there is maybe some security thing for the hood. I don't know. It's broken. Everything's broken. Look at this thing. It's broken. So if the system's been opened, usually you got to replace the dryer, accumulator, and receiver here. So I ordered this to install it, and there's fittings in here. They go in through here. And on this piece, there's a little switch that has to go in there. This thing is already loaded with vacuum, so this is sealed. The instant we crack that open, the clock's ticking against us. So this is what I need to put in. And of course it's down here in the most unpleasant little spot. I think you might be able to see some of the silver down here, probably not. But it's down there waiting to be put into place. So I need to put that on. This part was not actually all that unpleasant. You did want to use a universal. I tend to use impact universals because they don't wobble all over the place and get lost. And the factory ones were Torx or Allen. Allen, probably. And you can't quite get in there without a universal, so you're happy that you got a universal. And then pull it apart. And then there's one cryptic little bolt that I could not possibly get at the bottom. However, I was able to slide the accumulator up and just leave the rubber bushing still attached to the inner fender. And then I put the new one on. Left the rubber bushing stuck on the fender and just slid it right into place. The bracket on this is deliciously flexible, so you can kind of arm wrestle everything into position and reattach it. And then this one came with studs and nuts. And in order to fit it, I had to take the studs out of the accumulator and then thread them in through the top. But you can figure it out. You can see the nuts are right there, but I've got this little adapter. Oh, and a flexible extension. That was useful. It's amazing how many tools you pick up just by working on vehicles. Ugh. But this wasn't bad. So after the accumulator was put in, I hooked up to the low side again with a set of gauges. and pulling 30 inches of vacuum just to make sure there's no moisture, or any moisture that got in is boiled out and gone.
So I've got it pulling a vacuum. I'll let it run for about 30 minutes and then we'll put some refrigerant in and see if it works. I hope it works. Let's see. So I tested the compressor on the bench. The clutch does engage, so we're hoping that it's going to work. I put it in with a fair bit of language and pulled a vacuum on it for an hour and let it sit, and it seems to be doing pretty good. So now I'm going to try this. This stuff has some instructions. Nobody ever reads the instructions. And this says, review the regulations in your area. Here in beautiful British Columbia, there are regulations about how you should be dealing with this. In fact, to refill this with R134A, you need a certificate to get the 134A. I don't have that certificate. But you can get this at Princess Auto, Lord Co., Amazon, all over the place. So we're gonna try it this way. This stuff is not 134A, it's an equivalent that's not quite as hazardous. Once you put this over-the-counter kind of stuff in here, other shops are not going to want to deal with this AC system because this stuff will pollute their equipment. So you really don't want to do this. On this case, for this $500 beater, I don't care, and I can continue servicing it here, so I'm not going to take it to a shop and pay market value for the vehicle to get the AC serviced. So it's just a crunch in numbers. So we're going to follow the instructions with this and charge the system now that it's been holding a vacuum, and we're going to see if we can make this thing work.
As with many of my videos, you're watching me figure this out and then try to make it look like I knew what I was doing. So I threaded the thing onto the can, clipped the thing, quick release kind of fastener onto the low side, and then you'd thread this guy in until it perforates the can. So you can't actually take the can off until you're good. And I wasn't quite sure what it did. I perforated it, and then you got a bleeder off, or rather unscrew, and then it starts feeding pressure into the system. And you want to get it kind of in the good, and then you're going to run the engine and see how the pressure goes. In this case, I'm not quite sure what I'm looking at. But it worked out. There's more.
Looks like the compressor's getting going. It's moving fluid.
So it took 2 and a fart cans to fill the system. It might have been able to do it under 2 if I knew what I was doing, but I did pierce the third can and it has nice and steady readings, right in the good to happy zone, so I think we're winning. And it actually gets cold. Woohoo! Winds all around.
So we tested the AC, replaced some parts in the AC, put a vacuum on an AC, recharged the AC, and now we got AC. You can do the same. Oh yeah. As always, thanks for watching. Take care.